this announcement, and I would like to inform you that United Nations would like to express deep appreciation and thanks to Mr. Marcus Kummer, who was the interim chair of MAC for the 2013, for his great efforts, for his dedication and time that he spent to lead MAC and working with you together to make the 2013 IGF event is one of the most successful event within the history of the IGF. So that I would like to ask you to applaud and thank Mr. Kummer. Thank you very much for your support. I also would like to continue and make the announcement that taking in consideration the recommendations of MAG members, so that Mr. Wu, who is Under Secretary General of the United Nations of DESA, appointed Ambassador Yanis Kourkas as the interim chair of the MAG meeting. So, you know, Ambassador Kourkas, for his long time of the supporter, and I can use this word, as one of the founder of the WSIS and IGF, and it was really pleased to see him as the interim chair of MAC. Now I would like to give a floor back to Chengitai. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Slava. I would like now to call the honorary chair for these meetings, Dr. Ahmet Kavazoglu, head of International Relations Department from the Information and Communication Technology Authority of Turkey. Thank you very much. Can you please come up onto the stage? And also our new interim chair, Ambassador Cotland. I now give the floor to Dr. Ahmet.
Thank you very much. Esteemed colleagues, dear ladies and gentlemen. First of all, I would like to express my sincere appreciation that UN agreed to hold Internet Governance Forum in our unique city of Istanbul. Being intercontinental bridge with rich historical and cultural texture, I'm sure that IGF in 2014 will be a remarkable one and you will all enjoy your stay in Istanbul. Taking this opportunity, we look forward to welcoming you all in September in Turkey, in Istanbul. Since 2006, Internet Governance Forums have been providing an excellent platform for dialogue between all stakeholders of internet-related issues, forward-looking discussions, keeping the basic principles of transparency, accountability, and inclusiveness of all relevant stakeholders have been leading to improvements in good governance. Internet is an essential part of daily life. It has already shaped how we conduct our business, how we interact socially, and even how we provide our daily needs. Internet comes with great benefits. Also, it brings great challenges that are not like challenges we have settled before. In order to tackle all these, it's vital that all stakeholders speak the same language and have the same principles. Multi-stakeholder nature of IGF is a promising start of this. IGF provides good platform for discussion of various internet-related issues. Dear colleagues, safe, secure, and resilient internet are the main goals to be achieved for building confidence in cyberspace. It's also important to keep the norms that respect the national values and cultural diversity in the borderless nature of internet. Building trust and confidence to internet is not an easy task. It faces serious challenges. Cybersecurity is one of the challenging issue for all stakeholders. Safe and secure internet is important for national security, development, e-commerce, and privacy of users. In this regard, I believe that IGF will help all stakeholders develop a common understanding on cybersecurity and how to deal with it. I believe that today and tomorrow, we will have fruitful discussions for shaping the agenda of the IGF 2014 in addressing the important issues for further developments in good governance of internet. I'm very pleased to be here with this community and look forward to hearing discussions and proposals for successful IGF 2014. Having this change, I would like to congratulate Indonesia for hosting very successful IGF 2013 and would be very happy to hear their experiences and guidance for organization of IGF 2014. Expressing once again the great pleasure of IGF 2014 in Turkey, I trust that this meeting will be a successful one in achieving its planned purposes, which forms basis for successful outcomes of IGF 2014. Thank you very much for this opportunity that you have given me. And now I would like to give the floor to His Excellency Ambassador Yanis Karklins to chair the meeting.
So thank you very much, Dr. Ahmed, for your opening remarks and for the decision of the government of Turkey to host 2014 edition of Internet Governance Forum. So thank you. Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Before getting any further, I would like to start by inviting our previous chair, Mr. Markus Kummer, to address the meeting. Markus.
Thank you, Chairman. It gives me great pleasure to see a new team in charge and to see that the IGF is in good hands. And I wish you and the Honorary Chair all the luck and success in your endeavor. Looking back at last year's, it was almost a year ago we met in Paris and discussed how to prepare the 2013 meeting. That was shortly after the World Conference on International Telecommunication, which was a very divisive meeting, and we felt then it was necessary to build bridges, and we felt that the IGF was a good tool to build bridges between those who were opposed in Dubai. But the year continued, and disclosures about pervasive mass surveillance marked the year, and the IGF had to address this issue. And the IGF did address this issue. It was an open discussion we had in Bali, and the IGF also made a contribution towards building bridges between all stakeholders involved in the internet. Now, looking forward, 2014 will be an equally challenging year. There are many important conferences ahead of us, and the IGF will have to find its place in these conferences. But I'm sure under your guidance and leadership, the 2014 IGF will be the best IGF ever. Let me conclude by thanking you all for your support and cooperation throughout the year, and all the kind words addressed to me, and the very warm words addressed by Slava this morning. Very much appreciated, and I wish you good luck with the meeting. Thank you.
So thank you, Markus, for also for good wishes, and certainly I see that you're smiling, and certainly many of you can also see certain preoccupation in my face, and I guess why it is, because Markus just passed the bucket full of water to me and saying please carry it on without spilling water out. So dear friends, dear colleagues, let me thank all of you for confidence you're placing in me by nominating me in this position. I would like also to thank United Nations Secretary General, in person of Under Secretary General Wu, for confirming this nomination. I will do utmost I can. I will apply all my experience and knowledge and skills in managing the process and chairing the meetings, but certainly decisions which will be made by the MAG as a group which is designated by the Secretary General to prepare the IGF meeting. We have a number of differences, if I may say, and I will mention only two. 2014, as Marcus already mentioned, is a year where many important meetings will take place related to internet governance, and there are extremely high expectations that some decisions will be made in a truly multi-stakeholder manner. And of course, IGF is part of this internet governance ecosystem, and therefore expectations from 2014 meeting are very high. And secondly, this year we have less time for preparations. We normally, IGF is taking place at the end of the year, October, November. This time we will have in early September, which puts additional strain on the MAG, on all contributors to IGF. So we will need to work in accelerated speed. But as I told some of you already, we are condemned to succeed, and we will, together. And without further delay, I will go to the business of today's meeting, and we'll start with the question whether agenda, provisional agenda of the meeting, which has been distributed to all of you and is published on IGF website, is acceptable to guide us through this two-day meeting. So I see there is a request for the floor. Vlada, please, you have the floor.
Thank you, Yanis. Welcome as the new chair. There were a couple of thoughts shared on the MAG list previously, which were basically seems agreeable by most of the MAG members, so this is a suggestion for a slight change or improvement in the agenda of today. So for the afternoon session, instead of just having the topic on the IGF places, IGF's place in an evolving internet governance landscape, we should focus on the CSTD improvements recommendation, which under it has also the IGF place and links with other fora, but it also has parts on funding, outcomes, working modalities, broadening participation and capacity building. And it would really be good to try to have at least 2 hours to discuss the improvements, because it's a critical year, as you also said. And for tomorrow morning session, in the first part, I would recommend that we also have as an F point maybe e-participation, because it's something that we usually keep for any other businesses, and I believe that this is crucial for the success of the IGF. Thank you.
So thank you, Vlada, for these comments or suggestions. On the second one, I think in point B you can read e-participation, including e-participation. So that is covered. When it comes to your proposal on improvements, implementation of the decisions or recommendations of the working group on improvements of IGF, certainly we can discuss it. Idea, of course, was that as you also see in the terms of reference, these recommendations should guide MAG in all decisions, and they should. It is considered, at least I consider it as a cross-cutting theme, which should be present in all our debates. But certainly, we can allocate time in this part this afternoon to discuss. The implementation or state of implementation of these recommendations. Please.
Thank you, Janis. Henriette Esterhuizen, Association for Progressive Communications. Just supporting Vlada's suggestions on the agenda, and then maybe just one addition to that or elaboration of that, perhaps under item 3, the IGF's place in an evolving internet governance landscape. It would be useful if possibly Slava or the Secretariat can just give us an update on what the time frame is for the decision on the renewal of the IGF for a further 5 years, because as far as I understand, that decision is to be made before the end of this calendar year. And I think it would be very helpful for us to discuss that and possibly make suggestions on how we can effectively respond to that.
So thank you, Annette. Well noted. Marilyn?
Thank you. My name is Marilyn Cade. I'm one of the new business MAG members, and I'd just like to go back to both support the comment that Vlad made, but to reinforce the importance of our spending time as the MAG and as a group of interested stakeholders in understanding the range of events and activities in the ecosystem landscape, and then talking about the role of the IGF, because some of us are involved in some of those other meetings while other participants and members are not, and I think it would be important that we make sure that we are really thoroughly understanding the range of challenges and opportunities in the internet governance space and the IGF's role and ability to urgent need to strengthen and enhance and deepen its contributions to the challenges facing the internet. Thank you.
So thank you. I think that is covered with the point number 3 of the agenda. Any further comments? I see none. So then with these amendments, I consider agenda approved, and we can move to the first, to the second question of our agenda, stocktaking of IGF 2013 and looking forward to IGF 2014. So, but if I may suggest, let's take this one agenda item in two steps. First, let's talk about 2013, lessons learned, and sort of what kind of conclusions we can make and what we would bring forward to 2014. And after that, we would discuss how we should approach 2014 edition of IGF. So if that is acceptable, then I will invite the representative of 2013 host country, Indonesia, Mr. Nananda Avalist, from the Permanent Mission of Indonesia, to make remarks on behalf of the host country 2013. Mr. Avalist, you have a floor.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. Before I begin, please allow me to extend Indonesia's tribute to both Mr. Marcus Kummer and to you, Ambassador Janice Kirkland, Mr. Chairman, and in their capacities as former MAG Chairman 2013 and as the interim MAG chairman in 2015. It is, we are very delighted to note that IGF has been and will again be in good hands. Good luck with your future works. Since our national focal point for IGF, Mr. Mugiono, will only arrive tomorrow due to technicalities, I have the privilege to deliver Indonesia's remarks. I am pleased to share with the meeting that the 8th meeting of IGF has been convened in Bali on 22nd to 25th October 2013. The meeting was attended by 2,632 participants from 111 countries, with 1,700 other participated remotely from 83 countries. The main theme of the meeting was building bridge through multi-stakeholder cooperation for growth and sustainable development. Of course, the meeting discussed a diverse array of topics that may not be easily summarized, but there are highlighted substantive themes that were sustained throughout the meeting. The first one, amidst the public concern with regards to surveillance and monitoring activities through internet, IGF panelists and participants underlined the need for better protection for all citizens' privacy and security online by balancing actions between national interest and respect for internationally recognized human rights. Two, representatives from several governments emphasized the importance of finding common ground amongst all stakeholders of certain cyber ethics that place value on respecting local cultures online while safeguarding users from emerging cyber threats. Third one, all stakeholders reaffirmed the importance of strengthening and maintaining the multi-stakeholder spirit and mechanism in the internet governance. Indonesia wishes to thank its partners from Secretariat of the IGF, UNDESA, as well as a wide array of our national partners, both from public and private sectors. And if there was any lessons learned that may be derived from the meeting, it is the close cooperation between public and private sector that enabled the IGF 2013 as a success. And for that, we thank you all. Of course, as a way forward, Indonesia wishes to extend its well wishes for Turkey as the next host of the IGF in Istanbul. And of course, Indonesia will always be stands ready to lend its support in any way to the best of its ability. And good luck to Turkey. And of course, Indonesia is open for any comments and insights from all participants with regards to the enhancing the quality and for convening the IGF events in the future. By conveying that, Mr. Chairman, I thank you very much.
So thank you, Mr. Avalis, for these remarks. And once again, on behalf of the MAG, please accept our gratitude for all the contribution and the work your government did during the 2013 session. It was highly appreciated, and it was really a successful meeting. Now, before going to the discussion about the substance format and lessons learned from Bali IGF, I would like to ask Çengetay to introduce the synthesis paper, the document which puts together thoughts and comments made by many participants of Bali meeting as a result. And the document was sent to you a while ago. Nevertheless, the introduction, I think, would be helpful to inform our today's discussion. Çengetay.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. The IGF Secretariat put out a call for public input to all stakeholders to share their general reflections on IGF 2013 and recommendations for the IGF 2014. And suggestions or ideas for issues to be discussed at the 2014 IGF. Submissions and comments were compiled into a synthesis paper, which is available on the IGF website, and the individual contributions are under the contributions tab on the IGF website. As always, the contributions touched on a wide variety of issues. Some focus on taking stock of the 2013 meeting in Bali, while others made specific recommendations for the 2014 meeting. In total, about 26 contributions were received from various individual and organizational stakeholders. A list of those contributors are on the last page of the synthesis paper. In summary, the general comments, many expressed gratitude to the government of Indonesia for their successful hosting of the 8th IGF. It was said that the 8th IGF meeting in Bali was again an example of a well-organized meeting at an exquisite venue for which our appreciation goes to the host country and organizing team. Many contributions noted that the IGF had progressively matured in 2013 and discussions in Bali took many broad internet governance policy discussions forward towards points of convergence. Gratitude was expressed for the hospitality and generosity of the Indonesian host, the preparations done by the Secretariat and the host country throughout the year leading up to the meeting, UNDESA for providing the institutional home for the administrative support to the IGF Secretariat and for supporting the IGF process in general. The hard work of the multi-stakeholder organizing committee, the presence of the Indonesian public institutions, internet access, community media networks, civil society organizations, and human rights and minority sexual rights activists. The facilities, amenities, and the availability of food and coffee were said to be dramatically improved from the previous IGF. At the delegates' registration, wherein the staff assisted the delegates pleasantly, faster, and efficiently. The good layout of the main session rooms and workshop rooms for discussions, including the reconfiguration of the main room for some sessions. Continued recognition and appreciation for the availability of remote participation, for the remote hubs, and for remote moderation. Appreciation for the workshop transcripts, summary reports, webcasts, increased social media activity, and other records of the IGF meeting that can be found on the IGF website and on the internet. The IGF pre-events were also greatly appreciated, and many contributors recommended that they should both be continued and strengthened in 2014. The new delegates briefing session was also noted to be a welcome addition and should be continued and improved in moving forward. Some inputs strongly appreciated the human rights dimension of the 8th IGF, including the inclusion of topics related to human rights issues in its main agenda and providing a space for discussion in workshops. There were some criticisms on some aspects related to the 2013 meeting, which should be kept in mind when planning the 2014 meeting as follows. The late confirmation of the host country location made it difficult for many to participate fully. There were some visa issues which also made it difficult for some to join the meeting in Bali. Criteria for participation in the high-level leaders meeting on day zero was not clear for some, and the unintentional vulnerability of the registration process, which put some participants' personal information at risk. Those were the general comments received from the synthesis paper.
So thank you very much, Chengetai. Now floor is open for the first part of our discussion. It is format, lessons learned, substance 2013. Suvi, you please open this part of the debate.
Thank you, Anis. I want to start first by congratulating UNDESA and the Secretary General for an excellent choice of the chair. A big thank you to Marcus for everything that he's done for us. The last year has been a great learning experience. I am Subhi Chaturvedi. I come from India. I teach at a women's college, communication and journalism, and I run a foundation called Media for Change, which is a grassroots network in internet governance. I'm really happy to be here today. I want to start out by first a huge thank you for the Bali team for hosting the best ever IGF. A big round of applause. I don't know what the technical issues were, but we're really grateful for you know, to run this and run this so well, despite and against all odds. As a MAG, we did it, and we did it together. As far as what worked and what didn't work, our assessment, and we've had this conversation before, we need to get more new voices in the room. We need to be able to facilitate participation. And one of the things that I do want to flag today is an early confirmation of the venue and some sort of support, which the UNDESA and the Secretariat have been very willing and forthcoming. If we could look at strengthening this mechanism along with the fact that capacity building tracks, and we initiated this last year, but it was observed that 8 o'clock in the morning is not really the best time to have these meetings. So we want more new people to come in and engage. I also think in terms of innovation in both content and format, the last IGF worked in leaps and bounds. Truly building bridges. We took into cognizance emerging issues, and it was an excellent session, a full session that took stock and addressed difficult questions, important questions like surveillance, and what is the role that civil society and government can play together along with the technical community. As far as what we could have done more in terms of innovation and format, the deep well of and the seating that we experimented for the mains was an excellent idea. The fact that we could put out 6 policy questions or 7 policy questions per session worked really well. People had a sense and they knew what to respond to. I also see that we've taken a step forward in seeking inputs from the wider community. 10th of Feb, and this synthesis paper, my congratulations to Changathai and the Secretariat for churning out such a cohesive analysis of all the 26 inputs that were received. There is a lot that we have on the table. 2013 was a great learning experience. Istanbul and what we have on the agenda. So I'm glad that this afternoon we'll be looking at how the IGF can relate with other existing opportunities, other existing processes that exist in global internet governance. I second what Marilyn Cade has said. We need to be able to integrate and find our way forward in the policy dialogue. And I'm looking forward to from the community, listening from the community, because this is the first day and an open consultation as to how we can strengthen, improve the current IGF. ISOC has also submitted a paper which is exploring an IETF format, which looks at the policy role, a role that also looks at the impact that the MAG and the IGF can have. I do also want to call out on something that Anred suggested. If we could get clarity by when we're looking at a decision from UNDESA on the current existing process in the mandate of the MAG, that would be helpful. I'm looking forward to 2 things in particular. Some of us gathered together this morning for an informal meeting as to how the IGF can improve and also relate with other processes. And this is a lot from the lessons we learned from the last format. The one thing that we really need to strengthen is also remote participation and e-participation. We did very well, but we also have to make sure that remote moderators are sitting in a prominent place so that remote questions can be given priority. This time, I think we already have taken the right steps forward in seeking inputs from the community and then deciding on themes. I'm particularly also interested in the workshop rating format, which some of us had initiated last year. How is it that we can have more new voices? How is it that we can have an improved participation from developing countries and especially from emerging economies? Thank you so much, Chair.
Thank you, Subhi. For your comments, we do have also here in these consultations remote participation facility, and I'm now looking to our remote participation moderators, if you are hearing me.
That's enough.
if you're hearing me. So please, if there is, or if there are any comments coming from outside the room, please let me know by lifting your flag. So now I'm turning to the next speaker, Michael.
I'm Mike Nelson, brand new member of the MAG, and I have a unique perspective on the Internet Governance Forum because I've been a remote participant for every IGF except the last one in Bali. So I really want to second Subi's important point that we do a better job of reaching out to the remote participants. It should be that the largest obstacle to remote participation is the time zone. That's not been the case for most IGF meetings. But I'll just focus on a few of the program elements and things that I'd like to see different. Some of these are things that probably were not mentioned in the submissions because people were too polite, but I'm not polite. So I'd like to say that we have to do a better job of bringing new people in with new topics, because the complaint I heard repeatedly at Bali was that it's the same people talking about the same topics. And I think that means, in some cases, that those of us in the MAG who have been on panels should find somebody else to be on panels. But most importantly, we should find out ways to make sure this is not just a meeting about people who care about internet governance, and that it's not just a meeting of people who run the internet. It should really be a meeting with many people speaking about what it's like to rely on the internet, and getting their perspective, whether it's school teachers in remote areas, or bank presidents, or government officials. Let's talk about what it means to be on the receiving end of the decisions that are made by the various organizations involved in internet governance. I think in some cases it may be necessary, if we want to get high-level people who aren't in the internet governance game to participate, it may be necessary to have them beam in through Skype or some other means, and that should be welcomed. But I think the most important thing is to see if we can really expand the scope of the community, expand the community of people that we're bringing into these discussions, and look at the impact that internet governance has on these people. Two other very quick items. I do think we can do a better job on ensuring there's not as much overlap. Some very important sessions were put in opposition to each other. Panels that were almost on the same topic were scheduled right opposite each other, and that should be something we can prevent. In a few cases, there were some really exciting panels that had completely useless titles. I was on a fascinating panel on cybersecurity, and the title was Discussion with the Netherlands Ministry of State, or Foreign Ministry. That gave nobody any indication of what we were talking about. So again, these are mechanical things easily fixed. Thank you.
So thank you, Michael. Actually, you were very polite, in my view. If I may maybe invite all participants to stay technology neutral when we're calling remote participation, let's call it remote participation regardless of the means or software we would use for that, because there might be some vested interest in that. So joking. Next speaker is United States.
Thank you, Chair. My name is Liesl Franz, and I'm with the U.S. Department of State, and I'm joined by my colleagues here as well. And we're very happy to be here again for another opportunity to prepare for the next IGF. I would like to join the chair and the organization for their warm thanks for Marcus Kummer for all that he's done in his role as interim chair, but also his previous leadership of the IGF itself, and also join others in our warm welcome to you, Yiannis, for taking up the mantle of chairing this august but lovingly unwieldy group for this important process. So thank you and welcome. We'd also like to congratulate Indonesia and the host committee, but also the MAG and all the participants and session organizers for what we also felt was a very successful IGF in Bali last year. You know, it is the opportunity for the global multi-stakeholder community to come together for what we consider to be robust and substantive discussions on timely and salient issues. And as Marcus pointed out, we certainly did that in Bali in many ways. We were once again struck by the content-rich workshops and thoughtful discussions that took place, and also continue to reflect on how the IGF itself is nimble enough to reflect those issues that are top of mind every year. We truly believe that this ability for global and timely and candid and substantive discourse is the IGF's greatest value. I'll try not to repeat things that others have said, but one thing I'd like to say is that we were pleased to see the IGF embrace some innovative ideas for the workshop topics and the formats, as well as adding the newcomer briefings and the open mic sessions. Those provided for immediate feedback during the week, and I think that's an opportune time to get the feedback of those that participate, not just those that help prepare for the event. So we encourage the MAG and other stakeholders to continue to incorporate innovative ideas like that, like new formats, diversified speakers, new topics, as we prepare for the 9th IGF in Istanbul. And thank you to Turkey for hosting us this year. We look forward to joining much more of the discussion throughout the day, but that's it for now. Thank you.
So thank you. Thank you very much. One request from our interpreters is if you're reading prepared notes, if you would keep the pace of reading, let's say, in the same way as you would speak from the bottom of your heart.
I suppose that was your way of saying slow down, Lisa. We'll do my best.
So that is your interpretation, what I wanted to say. So now I would like to invite our friends from Russia. I cannot really read your nameplate. Sorry, it's a bit too little for me. Please, if you could introduce yourself as well.
Thank you, Chair. The National Research University Higher School of Economics. At first, I'd like to have some reflections over the 2013 IGF. And this is generally related to the my deepest appreciation of a lot of opinion was devoted to the human rights specific on the internet. Also, these topics should be expanded for the 2014, and we believe that this would be a great topic to discuss all issues in which internet governance would like to promote human rights worldwide. As for our delegation, which would like to remember the workshops we organized last year, it's about the displaced people and the services provided for displaced people, migrants. And after that, we'd like to we talked about free software as well in human rights context. And would like to continue this discussion this year in context of all three levels of internet governance, which are set in supranational, national, and community level. So that I would like to call upon the forum to expand the topic and to pay more attention to all human rights topics, especially of the rights of the minor protected people, migrants and displaced people and other. I believe that the internet governance is one of the good ways to promote their rights. Thank you very much.
So thank you for your suggestions, and then your colleague also wants to say something, please.
Thank you very much, Chair. So I just wanted to once more thank for, we appreciate your help and the efforts which were given to us last year in terms of organization of the two workshops, and especially that one oriented on services for displaced people. Actually, speaking with some MAG members and visitors of the IGF in Indonesia and Bali, we found out that the topic of services for displaced people was not fully covered in terms of other workshops or panels held in Bali, actually. So we would like to emphasize that it is necessary to focus on this side also of internet governance, of services provided through the internet for that, for those people. And also, I would like to emphasize that we are talking about a multi-stakeholder approach. So last year we had representatives from the government delegations, from the governmental delegation, from the business, and from civil society and also technical community. Unfortunately, ordinary visitors were not able to attend the panel because of other important panel discussions. That is why we also would like to think about earlier stage of planning workshops, a timetable, schedule, and so on, in order to not have that interruption of quite interesting topics at the same time, at the same place, right? But thank you very much.
So thank you for your comments, and now I'm turning to Andriet.
Thank you very much, Yanis. Also, thank you to the Secretariat for an excellent synthesis paper, and thanks to all of those who worked last year. Marcus, for your leadership, and I think particularly for the MAG having regular online meetings. That was an innovation in 2013. And I think one that we should maintain. It was very helpful. I'll just try to also add, as Liesl had, to what has been said rather than repeat. I think the most important reflection on the Bali IGF for ourselves are that it demonstrated its value as a very unique platform for open, inclusive dialogue. The Brazil meeting on internet governance that is coming up in April, I would see as emerging from the IGF. Obviously, there were preceding events, but it was at the IGF that this meeting, which could be quite a pivotal meeting, was discussed, and discussed in quite an open and animated way. And I think that's the value of the IGF. It's open to all, and any agenda topic can be discussed formally on the agenda or in the corridors. So I think the value of that, and also just to add to that, for some of you might know that at the moment participation in the Brazil meeting is subject of quite a complicated process, and participation is limited. We don't have those constraints with the IGF. The IGF is linked to the UN. It's open to participation to all. So I think whatever other processes happen, we should not lose appreciation of that value of the IGF. I won't reflect on main session or themes, we'll come to that later. Just a few remarks. I think on participation, our sense was that government participation is decreasing, and that you do have some governments that send large delegations. But overall, it felt, particularly from developing countries, that there were relatively few governments participating actively in the process. And I think that's critical. The value of the IGF as a space depends on participation from all stakeholder groups. So we think the MAG should consider mechanisms for strengthening that. One proposal that we would put on the table is that instead of having a high-level ministerial on the pre-event day, that event is rather a forum for governments to discuss public policy issues pertaining to the internet, with participation of other stakeholders, but primarily organized by governments for governments. Ministerial meetings have certain value. They bring high-level delegates, but most of those delegates leave by the end of that day. Perhaps having government personnel that's more involved in day-to-day internet governance issues for a pre-event and then staying for the entire IGF might have a better result. Just a few other remarks. I think we'll come to that later. But the number of workshops definitely is of concern, and we again propose that main sessions should not run in parallel. Also, I think the Bali meeting demonstrated the need for open spaces, white spaces. And many of you will know that the Brazil meeting and the Montevideo meeting preceding that from that the technical community had to be discussed during breaks. Or during lunchtime, or in conflict with other sessions. So I think we should recognize that the IGF is the space where issues emerge, and then schedule some open spaces for those topics to be discussed as they emerge. I think there's not much else to add. I'm very pleased that the ISOC proposal complements previous proposals. I'm coming up with quite concrete suggestions for implementing the CSTD working group's recommendation that the IGF is more outcome-oriented. At the same time, I think one shouldn't forget the value of the IGF as a space for dialogue. And then I, to some extent, with remarking on Mike Nelson's comments on participation and new topics and new people, I would qualify that somewhat, because I think it's not just a case of new people and new topics. It's about incrementally deepening existing discussions and bringing new voices into those discussions. But some of the main concerns around internet governance remain. And I do think debates are repeated, but I don't think just bringing new people is necessarily going to solve that. I think, as a MAC, we really need to look at the substance of the discussion and ensure that workshops and main sessions build on previous discussions. And then I think my final comment at this stage is just to remark on the capacity building track that Diplo and others organized at the Bali IGF. It received very positive evaluation from participants, and I think it's one of the values of the IGF is that, particularly as when new people come to the event, that it has this capacity building role. So I think certainly we should continue with that.
So thank you, Annette, for your comments, as well as for the document you distributed yesterday with the APC's comments on the 2013 and suggestions for 2014 IGF. So now I will turn to Izumi.
JP Nick, from the technical community. I attended the Bali IGF for the first time in terms of the IGF, and I'm also a new member of the MAG. So my impression about the IGF was I felt very good vibes about collaborating, collaboration between different stakeholders, especially in terms of cyber security related sessions and discussing the roles of different stakeholders, etc. But at the same time, I very much like the comments that Michael from Microsoft just made is about it's important to make sure we keep the people who are interested who keep the people involved in the people who are not necessarily interested in the internet governance topic itself. And what I felt was it was quite difficult to follow what are the themes, why are the themes being picked up is important this time, and what are the sessions that are relevant to this particular topic. So as a suggestion, what I think might be helpful is have some kind of tutorial or guideline kind of session introducing about general landscape of what's happening per topic that's being picked up as a general theme of the IGF, and then maybe share what are the sessions that are related to this particular topic that might help some of the newcomers understand a little bit more and be more actively participate. Thank you.
So thank you. I see we have a remote participation, a question from remote participant.
I have a comment from Angelic Ali Hossein del Castillo. I would also propose that the invitations for governments are sent out at an earlier date than last year. It could maybe make a difference in the participation of government officials from developing countries in the IGF. And I have another comment from Sandra. Hostier, and she says that the setup of the IGF village was very unfortunate, and especially for those placed in the last corner of the floor, and they have spent money on rating equipment, but it was not very efficient. Thank you.
Okay, thank you for those comments. Now, Subi.
I do want to echo the fact that the IGF, and there is no other forum which is as inclusive, transparent, multi-stakeholder and bottom-up. And for this to remain effective, we need to have more government and more government participation. From someone who comes from a developing country and closely engages with the government in my country, it has been my constant endeavor to make sure that we amplify government participation, because when we go back home, we have to take these decisions and we make sure that they're implemented or have some role in the new policies that we write for the internet. The one thing that has worked for us is we got the government to propose a workshop, and which was then translated after consistent mentoring by the MAG into an open forum. And the idea to have open forums where government can participate and tell their stories is a good way to have government representatives participate in the IGF. Most of them need invitations to be able to get leaves and sanctions on travel. If they're not panelists or if they're not actively running a workshop, it becomes difficult for them. I think there is also a deep and a reasoned and a discerned interest from the Indian government to participate in a similar session or to host an open meeting where we can amplify the role of governments in internet governance policies and public policy making. The high-level ministerial, I do agree, is a good idea and we should retain it. It allows governments to listen and hear and take inputs from other multi-stakeholders. So just looking at a session of the governments by the governments might not work. I think we need to find middle path. On the idea of new voices, I want to go back and say this again and again, and as many times it takes for us to realize that the IGF should not be, under any circumstances, be seen as a club of people who are at the meetings, same people, same panel, same voices, and the same depth and breadth of those conversations. We might not have a fantastic workshop, but it is important to mentor, and we suggested that the capacity building track can also take an active role along with some of the MAG members, and to have a process of workshop evaluations that does not keep people out, that does not exclude voices, but is inclusive. So though the workshop proposals might not be as well articulated, English is not the first language of many people across the world. We need to be able to mentor them. They might not even know who to reach out in terms of panelists, because we are also rating them on how fully developed or well articulated the proposals are. So one of the good ideas for us to do is to create a resource pool of people who have expertise on subjects and not hold this against those proposals. I do want to also cite the Indian Open Forum that we had, which was about connecting the next billion online, and they're going to come from countries such as India and China. Those are the numbers. This would not have happened. It was almost kicked off the workshop proposals. So we have to find new ways so that good proposals or potential proposals do not fall in between the cracks. So government is welcome, needs to be able to participate more, but we as a MAG and as the IGF need to create facilitating processes to be able to get them on the table. Thank you.
Thank you, Subi, for your comments. Now I'm turning to ICC bases.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. And first, I would like to congratulate you on your appointment to this position. Ambassador Karklis, we have full confidence that we will be in good hands this year in organizing the IGF. The ICC basis would like to congratulate, as others, Indonesia, especially the Minister of Communications and Information Technology, the organizers, particularly the IGF, for the efforts they put in, the IGF secretariat team, and especially our good friend Changitai, for all the work that they put in organizing the IGF this year. I would like to thank the United Nations Department of Economic and Social Affairs on this successful event, and we look forward to working with all stakeholders, and especially in including the host country, to prepare for another successful IGF in 2014. We'd like to also make a special thanks, and also personally a thanks to Marcus for the great work he did in helping shepherd the group last year and bring a successful IGF. ICC Basis believes that the IGF in 2013 continued to bring together an extensive range of leaders from many communities interested in internet governance. And it provided a unique opportunity to have frank and open discussions on a wide range of issues that is not always available elsewhere. It's very important in terms of participation to continue to strive for greater geographical diversity. As others have pointed out previously, we value the participation of all governments and would also like to increase participation, especially from the developing countries, so that we can have even a wider diversity of views and discussion in the sessions. To increase participation also, we strongly recommend that in the future that host countries make every effort to ensure that the date and location of the IGF are confirmed early, and comprehensive arrangements are made for visas well in advance of IGF, so that everyone who can make the advance plan they need to attend the IGF, we don't want to restrict participation just because of visa problems or lateness of notification of the location. In terms of sessions, just some general comments. We have about 20 pages of comments that we submitted, and I have no plans to go through all of them here, so no worries there, just some general ideas. But I'd like to encourage lead contacts for sessions in the main room and workshop organizers to have preparatory calls with panelists prior to the IGF. Structure, we felt the structure of the main and focus sessions were much improved this year. It meant that the sessions were much more interactive and focused. In addition, more roundtable sessions would improve the format of some of these and to promote interaction. So we encourage further improvement along those lines as well. The increased efforts to ensure workshops and other sessions submit a report have been important, and we encourage improvement and continuation of improvement on those efforts as well in terms of providing reports out of the workshops and sessions. Another thing that will probably be discussed, I'm sure, later is consideration of creating the best practices documents that had been created in the past and looking at ways of continuing that as well going forward. That is all I have for now, and I thank you very much, and I look forward to working closely with everyone for a successful IGF in 2014. Thank you.
So thank you very much. Now I'm turning to Virat.
Thank you, and my congratulations on your appointment. A big th- thanks to Marcus for his outstanding leadership, both as the interim chair as well as the IGF before that. I think much has been said by my business colleague here today and also participants from India. I just want to make some specific remarks, even though I represent business, about ensuring a greater participation from governments and civil society, especially from the emerging countries. The fact that we need more diversity and go beyond the 83-country mark that we have reached is, I think, uncontestable. It will come with new issues. It will come with issues that they think is important. And when these voices come into the meeting, they will shape IGF in the way IGF deserves to be shaped. I think existing issues are important, but I also believe that there are multiple places where existing issues are being discussed. I think it is also time to open ourselves up to challenges and success stories that are already existing. An impression that I've carried from the last six IGFs is that we tend to have a lot less discussion about success stories and how internet is changing people's lives for the better than the discussion on challenges. Now, that's not designed, but that's how it sort of comes across as a person who's been in these meetings, on panels, discussion both in person and remotely. The one big standout for the Indonesian conference and its success was the ability of the organizers to arrange the main room into a round table, actually a square table seating for some of the sessions. I have to submit to you and to the other distinguished colleagues that we've had that experience in India 2 weeks ago, and at the first go, the dignitaries and the ministers were a bit surprised that they weren't sitting on a panel lecturing people. But by the time we ended this discussion of 100, which had a square table of about 30 participants, members of parliament, civil society, business, government, they walked out saying, we want to have every single meeting where everybody is able to participate on an equal footing. So formats are important. And I think Indonesia took lead there. I have to say, asked for that format, and they couldn't convert it for us for a session that the Indian government did, and we were all helping organize that. But having said that, that was a paucity of time and wasn't, you know, possible. But I think we would request Turkey and the Secretariat to look at the possibilities of shaping rooms and discussions around formats that make it easier for people to participate rather than always be in a panel situation. I also want to say that ministerials are important. If we are looking to get developing countries involved, then we need to start thinking the way governments in developing countries think. Ministers will come into the IGF, and they will be leading big delegations with important policymakers if they believe they have a role in an important ministerial. We should never underestimate the importance of protocol for vast majority of the countries who will not be able to send their ministers and top officials for 5 days. So we have to create sessions and discussions around their participation. None of these should be exclusive only to governments, but I think there is a positioning that needs to be given to the ministerial that allows for such a dialogue, and we must very carefully plan that. I'd also emphasize on the issue of best practices, taking off a little bit from the ISOC outstanding paper that they have circulated. I think we should all strive to making the Istanbul IGF the big impact IGF. The IGF this year is coming at a time where there is unusually high level of dialogue on some very key issues: the vicious review, the CSTD working group on enhanced cooperation, the Brazil meeting, the plenipot. I can't think of a single year where such important dialogues across the world are occurring in a multi-stakeholder process. We must use IGF this year not only to be a high-impact meeting, but to be the catalyst for the dialogue and the outcomes that come from these reports. In several places, they would just be start of discussions. In some places, we will have recommendations or reports. I think IGF is also placed in September, which comes at the end of most of these meetings and just before the plenipot. So the timing is actually quite perfect. I would close by saying that one of the ways to make sure that we can get new voices of people who are actually making a success of internet in the developing country and the governments to come to the IGF and participate with gusto is to have sessions sharing international best practices. Access and diversity, I would just take as an example, is a huge one. According to the ITU, only 40% of the world is online, 2.8 billion people. 40% of the homes are connected, which means 60% of the world, which is nearly 70% of Asia, 70% of Africa, is yet to be connected. I think we should pick the low-hanging fruits. Access and diversity is one of the subjects where outstanding results have been delivered in a public-private partnership with the contributions and inputs of the academia and the civil society. If we can use, or we can start at the Istanbul IGF to do best practices demonstrations by countries who have succeeded in access and diversity, that'd be a good place to begin. And those documents can take the form of an outcome document, and other countries who are wanting to have that discussion. And there are dozens of countries across Africa and Asia where access and diversity is still a huge issue. Multilingualism is a massive issue. Some of the other issues that we are discussing a lot are still outside the radar screen. Very important, but these are the big concerns. So if we can engage them on best practices, on success stories, on the good stuff that internet has been doing for average citizens across the world, especially women and children, that should help make IGF the big impact IGF starting this year. Thank you.
So thank you, Yerat. Just a kind reminder, we're talking about lessons learned in 2013, and about the 2014 edition, we'll be talking after that. Let me tell you one story. One friend of mine said, "Why don't you write a doctor thesis?" And I answered, "You know, I don't have a time." And he said, it's not the right answer. You have a wrong priorities." And that is the story comments your sort of remark about ministerial participation. We have examples that full-fledged cabinet ministers stay in IGF for the whole time. We have example that deputy ministers stay for the whole time and are engaged. So therefore, what we need to do, we need to convince ministers and deputy ministers that IGF is important, and they should plan in their calendars participation. I have now a number of requests for the floor. The list is Mr. Chen, Paul Wilson, Delegation of China, Olga Cavalli, and Marilyn Cade. And then there is also further requests, but let me start with Mr. Chen.
Dear Chairman and dear colleagues, good morning. Since it's my first time to take the floor, I would like to take this opportunity to extend my congratulations on your appointment as the interim chair. Since Now we are concentrating on the lessons from 2013. So I would like to draw the attention of dear colleagues to one lesson I learned from my experience of being the member of being the MAC member for the last year. You may recall that last year in Geneva we had the second round of consultation or meeting of the MAC in Geneva, and we had a very heated discussion about the selection of workshops and deciding a decision on themes and sub-themes. At that time, one of the important points I made is, why don't we preserve the sub-themes format which we have already used in the previous years, which is quite a balanced one. But of course, most of the colleagues decided to have innovation. We have a new sub-themes. And then I compared the new version and the older version. I found the biggest difference is about the sub-theme 4, security, openness, and privacy. And the new sub-themes have the keyword of privacy has disappeared from the new sub-themes. But actually, just 1 month later, we got the case, famous or infamous, I don't know. But anyway, that case of Mr. Edward Snowden has stirred the big public interest among the world about the protection of privacy issue. And of course, we know that we decided to allocate more time for human rights issues at the Bali IGF, and it's a good action which we took. But my idea, or the lesson I learned from my experience on this issue, is for IGF and for all the multi-stakeholders and for all constituencies, we should always keep our eyes on the overall picture of the landscape of internet governance. We know we value the multi-stakeholder approach, we value inclusiveness, but it should not only just lie, it should not only be empty words, we should put it into our action. Last year, we can see, we can see the accelerating pace of discussions about internet governance. I also saw the mushrooming of different meetings and processes about internet governance. So under these circumstances, what is the value of IGF? What is the future of IGF? What IGF really can do, or what is the unique value of IGF? I think all dear colleagues, we need to think about it before we talk about how we proceed with 2014 IGF. Because there's another factor we need to consider, that is, we are coming to the end of the second term of authorization of IGF, and we only have 2 years away. We need to make use of this time, this 2 year time span, to think about the future of IGF. This is the first point I made. The second is about the role of the government. I fully concur with Subi on this issue. I'm speaking as a representative of the constituency, my constituency, as a government. Government is always an important, part or constituency of the internet governance. Without its meaningful involvement and participation, how can we expect a fruitful and useful principles or guidelines or public policies to come up, to emerge? So the second point of my idea is we need to get governments especially the governments of the developing countries, more involved in IGF. The third point would be about the internal governance of MAG. We know MAG plays a very important role in deciding on the agenda and format of IGF. So our work is of critical importance for success or failure of IGF. In order to make our work fruitful, I think we need to strengthen our internal governance. Now we only have three meetings each year, and we have a secretariat based in Geneva, but all the members of the MAGAs are dispersed all around the globe. How can we strengthen or intensify our dialogue to make our work more productive and efficient? I think this is a question which needs us to think about carefully. Of course, I'm looking forward to working together with all the members, colleague members of the MAG, try to make this two days consultation successful and fruitful. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
So thank you, Mr. Chen, for your observations, and certainly the why we are coming together in IGF. It is an important question, and everybody needs to understand. All participants need to understand that. That's for sure. So next to my list is Paul Wilson.
Thank you. It's Paul Wilson here from APNIC. I won't repeat all the thanks and congratulations that have been said so far, but I do want to sincerely echo them. I do want to say thanks to the Secretariat for the synthesis paper on the 2013 meeting, and to all the support that they've given to this to that meeting and this process. But so talking about Bali, one thing I heard again that hasn't been mentioned so far, I think, is for us to put more thought into the continuity of the IGF process between meetings. I heard again the need that people feel to have more information about the meeting that they're attending, about the program, and about the individual sessions that they might be interested in, things like background information and discussion papers and so forth. I think that's something that we could consider in the workshop selection process and in developing the agenda for the coming IGF, to respond to that feedback, which, as I say, I have heard more than once before. I think a related issue, and I think it's quite important as we look at IGF renewal into the future, is the need to be able to understand the progress of the IGF process and the kind of the position of a particular meeting or the content of a particular meeting in the context of a whole process. You know, what I mean is to have a sense of progress from the last IGF meeting to the one that you're attending to the next one. So I think that continuity is going to be pretty important in the renewal of IGF, to be able to see what the IGF has achieved in its first 10 years and what it can achieve or is planned to achieve in future. I want to say I think the one really exciting advance that actually supports this very strongly is the Friends of the IGF website, which I hope everyone has seen it. It gives a fantastic searchable archive of all of the past IGF meetings. So I'd like to think that we in the MAG here could talk about how to support that initiative, because it really is quite groundbreaking in the history of IGF. Another thing which I think would help this question of continuity is to support some sort of agreed or recognised intersessional activity to encourage ongoing community engagement in IGF between meetings. Not a set of formal processes, which I think would be difficult, particularly at the start, but a space for discussion and exchange among the community. And that could, if that was run in an open bottom-up manner, it could allow processes to emerge voluntarily from it. So I'd be interested to discuss that at some point during this meeting. Logistically, I think it's essential to have more resources at the Secretariat. The Bali meeting was a great success, but the Secretariat resources required to really carry out the preparations in a way that I think the IGF deserves still weren't there. If the IGF can't mobilise more Secretariat resources than there has been, or in any case there's been some talk of a volunteer support group made up of some MAG members who could declare themselves as willing and available to play a bigger role in supporting the Secretariat activities. So I hope we'll discuss that as well. A couple of things I notice about remote participation just here. I think the remote scribing we're seeing here at this meeting has about a 45-second delay. The screen in the room here isn't particularly useful for that reason, and I think that delay is going to cause some problems in any discussion that might be happening between this room and outside. And finally, on a remote participation issue for this meeting, a contact I had in Germany says that YouTube is displaying a message that says that this video is not available in Germany because it may contain music for which GEMA, the Music Rights Licensing Authority, has not provided licenses in Germany. So I haven't heard any music, but maybe the French channel has got something playing, but maybe we could do something about that to help our remote participants. Thanks.
So thank you, Paul. For information, there is a lot of references to IGF Secretariat. We need to understand, we need to know what we're talking about. We're talking about Çengetay as a permanent member of Secretariat, and we're talking about people who are contracted on a short-term basis, and we're not talking about dozens, we're talking about one or two. So there is also some limitations on the task that we can expect from Secretariat to perform. We're all just humans. Next to my list is China.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. And I would also first take this opportunity to extend the thanks and appreciation to Indonesia and congratulations to Mr. Chairman. And on behalf of Chinese delegation, I would also give some points regarding the IGF. For the first point, it is well known that IGF is the outcomes of VCS meeting, and obviously the next year is VCS plus 10. All the countries has started their 10 years review regarding the VCS. So IGF should also pay attention to the topics why the IGF was coming into being. I mean the topics including IG4D, the Internet Governance for Development, the managing critical internet resources, and security, openness, and privacy, all the issues should be discussed continuously on the platform of IGF. Secondly, considering the rapid development and the present situation of internet, China delegation suggests the cybersecurity and privacy protection should be emphasized in the coming IGF's meeting. It is well known that the topics is a very key issues for the following development of internet. The third point is that we suggest still encourage the involvement of developing countries to IGF. You know, considering the existence of the digital divide, it's hard for developing countries to participate in the IGF. And in fact, for the situation of the developing countries, the government takes very important roles in the development of internet in the developing countries. So China suggested, proposed that we should find more mechanism and fundings to push forward the involvement of developing countries' government to push forward them to be involved in the IGF meeting. Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Thank you, distinguished delegate from China, for your points. We will certainly took note, and that is mostly related to the preparation of 2014 meeting. So thank you. We are still on the lessons learned and comments on 2013, and the next on my list is Olga Cavalli.
Thank you, Chair. First, let me congratulate you for your appointment. It's a pleasure working with you again. And I want to thank Marcus for his leadership and in previous years of our work in the MAG. I would like to bring a perspective from developing countries in Latin America. In my experience in reporting back and forth in all the years I've been participating in the MAG, one thing that always happens is that people ask, why should I go to a meeting that it's such a long way from home, so expensive, if I cannot bring home concrete ideas and concrete examples of how to improve policies and what to do at the local policy space? So my suggestion for what I have learned from interacting with my own government in Argentina and with other governments in Latin America is that it could be useful to have more concrete examples of how to move forward, how to improve policy. Themes of focus sessions and workshops should be really a way of bringing home tools and interaction with other experts that could be useful when the time comes and they come home again. Luckily, there will be two next IGF in our region, but for the moment, it has always been a long way to go from Latin America to Bali and now to Turkey. So I think Virat said something around this idea. Policymakers should be able to interact in round tables and express their problems and get ideas when they come home. So this is my comment from my interaction with my government and other governments in the region. A workshop should be also focused. And I would also support the idea of doing a best practice document, as ICC Basis said, and also support the capacity building session. And if there will be a group of MAG volunteers for helping the secretariat, please count on me for that. Thank you so much.
So thank you, Olga, also for your commitment to help us out. Marilyn.
Thank you. Marilyn Cade speaking, one of the business new MAG members, but my observations about the Bali meeting are being made as a stakeholder, because I was both not a MAG member then, but was a very active participant. And so I want to share the perspective from as an observer and participant in the process all the way through of some of the lessons that I think can be taken from Bali, but some of them reflect back into Baku and into earlier IGFs as well. First of all, in any complex experience, what one often benefits from is a spirit guide. And I say that because I think that many of the people who have contributed as active participants in the IGF, who may now be a MAG member like myself, actually spent the last several years being a participant and a contributor in a workshop proposal or as a panelist or in some other way. And we have the opportunity to be mentors and coaches and welcoming other new participants to help them be effective participants. I think one lesson that I take from my experience of being a participant is that in the past, sometimes the MAG behaved like a private club. And that is not what we want to be, and nor what will help us to most advance the success of the IGF. Last year, there was a very distressing, unfortunate experience that took place related to the selection of workshops that has left a bad taste in a number of proposers' stomachs or mouths. And while the MAG did not mean to create misunderstandings, what happened externally was that an agreement was reached by the MAG to establish criteria for workshops, and rating was done by the MAG of workshop proposals, which included workshop proposals from the MAG members. Let me explain externally how that looks and feels when your workshop proposal, wasn't mine, but three of the workshop proposals that I had tried to coach into applying were rejected, but they couldn't understand why. They didn't feel that they were given the opportunity to improve their workshop. Two proposals from countries were rejected because they weren't asking for the right event. So a lesson I've learned externally, having developed workshop proposals myself in the first 2 years, helped to coordinate a main panel in one of the sessions in India on cybersecurity, coached others to help develop workshop proposals and open forums, is that I think there is a significant need for an attitude of coach and mentor on the part of the MAG members to help others to become successful participants in workshop proposals, so that there's more of us helping others be more successful. But I say that as someone who was not a MAG member, but was outside. I also want to say that a couple of quick things about strengthening the Secretariat, and I think this is a lesson that I have learned. I personally am not interested in seeing MAG members take on functions of the Secretariat. I am interested in the MAG and in others building the financial resources so that we have a sufficient resources within the Secretariat. And I also, another lesson that I learned over the past several years is that when we had both Marcus and Changatai at the Executive Secretariat, we were able to have either Marcus or Changatai in participation at key meetings, whether that was national and regional IGFs or the CSTD or coming to the ICANN meetings to help to proselytize and build the understanding about the IGF and therefore strengthen the awareness and understanding and visibility of the IGF. And I think the lesson I learned last year is without sufficient resources and presence in these other meetings, I think we suffered a little bit in terms of visibility. Finally, we must get the dates set much earlier, which we've done this year, and I really appreciate that, and we need to actually be able to start the hold the date process almost immediately so that people in this very busy calendar period can, whether they are a workshop participant or not, they know they need to be holding the date and the location. And I applaud the fact that we benefited from last year's experience in improving and accelerating the availability of the date. I have a number of ideas about this year's session, but I think that those comments belong later. Thank you.
So thank you, Marilyn. Jivan.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. My name is Ljubcha Jivan Georginski. I had this experience when I was in university, and the professor would be giving back the essays, and they are called, you know, John Doe, this, that, Steve, and then a few seconds of pause, and I knew it was mine. So thank you for using, and I propose that you use Jivan for easier access, otherwise we'd be drowned in consonants. I am a new government member from Macedonia. I work in the Ministry of Foreign Affairs. I'm a diplomat there. But I was involved in the internet governance debate some years ago in the WISIS process, and then some later until perhaps IGF Athens. And I've kind of stepped out for the past few years. I must say that though I'm sure that there is a lot of progress, I see a lot of the same kind of discussions that were happening then happening still, without some breakthroughs, tangible breakthroughs in them. I hear that Bali was successful, and perhaps that is because the Snowden affair was there. So perhaps it helped to focus things on something tangible. And I'm glad that it put human rights more on our agenda. So I do think that we need to be result-oriented. I think that we need to be careful when we say that we should have more topics here. I heard a colleague say that we should focus on the landscape. I couldn't agree more, and that we should focus on action in order for there to be value added. So in that sense, ISOC's idea for to copy or to use the IETF's RFC way of proposing new initiatives is perhaps an idea long overdue. This has been an idea that has been brewing since the very beginning, and I think that that is the way to introduce new topics and to make the good ones, the good ideas, bubble up to the surface in a proper manner. We should not forget, in having saying this, because we keep on saying that the government and or governments and ministers, when they come to the IGF, should be taught, they should hear. If a minister comes and is present, I think that they're a committed minister to dedicate their time. So that would be preaching to the converted. What I do think that the value added of perhaps a government at the international level is to use what the MAG and the IGF is, or rather where it takes its mandate from. And it takes, we should not forget, its mandate from the General Assembly, from the Secretary General. And we should use these channels, because the fact that IGF is up for a renewal with a GA vote should be reminder enough of where the housing is in that sense. So when we speak, for instance, on human rights issues, we should not forget that right beside this hall is the Human Rights Council. The Human Rights Council is considered to be one of the most successful bodies that has emerged from the UN system, very results oriented. So we should use these use this channel of being right beside it and having some kind of output that would come out from both the MAG. And we are a multi-stakeholder advisory group to the Secretary General of the UN, and as well from the IGF, where outcomes come out with proposals, perhaps to the UN bodies, like the HRC, like ECOSOC, which is the home for this body as well, in a way. So just to put all of this together is focus on results, and I think that the UN system provides some good channels for that. I don't think that they should be the only channels. I think that there's a lot of good channels to be used. But for us to have a value added and to prove our worth in the middle and long term, we should use those channels on specific outcomes, specific products, in the way of proposals. Thank you.
So thank you, Juan, for your comments. Next is Council of Europe. Lee.
Thank you, Mr. Chair, and congratulations to you. Thank you to Marcus and to Chengetai and the team for all the good work. Thank you to the Indonesian government. I found the Bali IGF very smooth in its functioning and very responsive to some of the hot topics which came about last summer. I found that responsiveness very, very accommodating in last year. The Council of Europe is ever present in the work of the IGF. Thank you very much for that. And even if it's an intergovernmental organization with 47 countries, it finds itself in the world with many different actors. And I would like to say from the beginning that the IGF is making or helping the Council of Europe do its job properly. So, it quite clearly internet governance over the years has grown. Internet governance in the Council of Europe has become a priority, thanks to the IGF. Some of the learning, some of the remarks I'd like to make is that human rights seems to still every year dominate the discussions. I am predisposed to that because of my work, but many people talk about that, and it's not going away. I don't think that's going away. It's going to carry on growing. So how do we accommodate that discussion? Whether you call it human rights or whether you call it the fact that people are at the center of this process, whether people have something, someone mentioned, I think it was Mike Nelson mentioned, the reliance on the internet. It's about people's reliance on the internet and their expectation, which is key here. The reliance on the expectation. So how do we talk about the reliance and the expectation? Are we doing enough there? So I found that the discussions were very timely, very topical. I know that because this year in 2014, the topics on the IGF Bali are still here in 2014, whether that be a guide on human rights for internet users, which we're doing in the Council of Europe, whether that means protecting the internet, doing no harm to the internet, protecting the ecosystem, the landscape, framing the ecosystem with internet governance principles or net neutrality. These things are still very, very topical now, and I think that's also thanks to the IGF. So I think it's helping us do our job better. This space is helping us do our job better, and that cannot be said enough, really, even if it's difficult to make it tangible. It makes us at the Council of Europe be embracing the different actors in a less intergovernmental sense of the word. It brings it back to Europe in our context, so we find a trace in Europe of the things which we discussed in Bali last year. It validates that work, it kickstarts new work, which we can then do. I think that's important to understand, is that the IGF is a kickstarter for new work coming through. But I do think bottom line is that internet governance is a sign of the times. And I would put forward that it's a sign of next level democracy. We don't talk about democracy, but I think it's a much bigger issue there, which we need to address. Just one question about the format. Someone mentioned about the format. I think that's very important. You know, I also work in the field of the Euridic, and the question of matching the discussion with the actors involved and making those actors feel comfortable is very, very important. I don't think you're going to get many national security institution representatives talking openly about how they do their work with regard to surveillance. So perhaps there's a need to think about which target groups we're talking about and matching the formats to those target groups. Whether that's an open discussion or a less open discussion or Chatham House rules, I think those things need to be more tailor-made and worked out in more details. Thank you very much, Chair.
So thank you, and I think Yuli encompassed very, very well the reason, raison d'etre of IGF. That helps us do our work where we're working. So thank you for that. ICANN, Chris.
Thanks, Yanis, and all the thank yous and congratulations to everyone concerned. I just wanted to make one very quick point, picking up on the on lessons learned, picking up on the point from my distinguished colleague from China who commented about the sub-themes, and specifically privacy. It's correct that we moved away from the original sub-themes that we've had for a number of years, and it's correct that the Snowden events created debate around security and privacy, amongst other things. But the lesson that I learned was not that we should stick with the original themes, but rather that actually the IGF is masterful at adapting. Even though we didn't have security and privacy specifically as sub-themes, we were able to have serious and vibrant debate on the issues that the Snowden revelations raised within the context of the IGF and within the context of the sub-themes that we had put in place. So I would encourage the MAG to continue to innovate, to continue to keep adjusting and tweaking the sub-themes moving forwards. Thank you.
Thank you, Chris. Now, Izumi. Izumi Aizu.
Thank you, Chair. And yes, I'm the second Izumi. It's not that popular name in my country, but somehow accidentally we are now too. So use my family name if so needed. But anyway, I was just trying to compare the statistics or attendance statistics of last year's one with that one of the 2012, Bali and Baku. It was kind of interesting that by the regional analysis, of course, the Asia-Pacific made increase by 7%, and which also host country of Indonesia made 1%, meaning over the Azerbaijan. Or if it comes to the absolute number, Indonesia had 580 people, roughly speaking. Because I sort of multiplied the number of participants overall, and also the percentage the Secretariat provided, because we don't have the real breakdowns in detail. Anyway, So that means Indonesians made a great effort to increase the number of participants from the host country. However, if you consider the number of population of two countries, where the Azeri has 9 million and Indonesia has 270-something, so it's not perhaps fair to just compare the two countries like that. But it indicates something. But what was also interesting is that for the stakeholder group, yes, several people mentioned about the decrease of the participation of the government. And the statistics certainly confirmed that. The civil society made the 13% increase by percentage, meaning reaching 46% of the whole overall participants. So myself being a member of the civil society, we are close to the half, whether it's good or bad, up to your interpretation. And the private sector also made, well, in the share, they lost by 1%, but actually in numbers, they have increased more. So that should be also taken noted. But while the government had only a 340 people as compared to the 416 of those of Baku, making absolute decrease by more than 70 people and about 9% decrease. And so I think certainly there is a need perhaps to reach out more to the government people, given a different political context and also the location of Istanbul. It may not be the case, but in any way, I think we need more effort to reach out all sectors, perhaps not only the governments. But finally, there's the gender balancing. And this, we maintain almost the same figure that was on the 65 to 35 in Baku, that male had more than the female. But it went to 63 to 37, while the 180 more ladies came to Bali than Baku. But the gentleman or the man came by 220 increase. So in the absolute number, both made a significant effort. But still, I don't think this 65-35 is not a fair balance, that we need to reach out more to the female. That's for our task jointly. Yet I noticed that there's no breakdown about the developing countries. There's only the grouping by the region, Asia-Pacific, where we have both developed and developing. I don't know if it's appropriate to go into that details or not, but at least if we have some idea about those from LDCs, which I think are vastly underrepresented amongst even the developing countries. There are more people perhaps from China and very few from the LDCs in Asia-Pacific, I can notice. So that is also the work I think we need. I just need one more clarification perhaps or question, that this total number in the chairman's summary, it says it includes a remote participation in a vague term. Is it really true? And can we have some means to know the breakdowns of how many are actual remote participation and how many are the physical ones, so that we can track of these sort of more exact numbers? I picked up that about 100 people were remotely participated and presented at the Bali meeting, but I'd like to echo the need for the remote participation enhancement, that we better have perhaps exact figures so that we will have more strategic move. And finally, perhaps I'd like to suggest that the word remote is a little bit troublesome to me, rather than, I would like to suggest to use online to be a little bit more neutral. Thank you.
Thank you, Izumi, for your comments and suggestions. Yes, I asked if Chingitai could, at a later stage. The numbers of remote participation, and as well whether there is any specific reason why we do not do the breakdown in terms of number of from developing countries and LDCs. Before Chengetai is giving answer, I will call on Matthew Sears. Then I have also Robert and Anna on the list. So Matthew, please.
Thank you, Chair. Matthew Shears of the Center for Democracy and Technology. I'll be brief, but first let me congratulate you and welcome you to the position of chairmanship. I very much support comments that have been made by many here, and particularly the comments by the Council of Europe. But let me follow up on a comment by the gentleman from Macedonia and Krista Spain. I would like to very much support and congratulate the IGF on the session it held on surveillance at the Bali meeting. I thought that was an extremely valuable session. We had a good set of panelists. And importantly, we had an excellent use of the open mic to have people participate and contribute in a true discussion format. And I think it points to the need for the IGF to not shun away from difficult issues. The more that we can remain current in our debate, the more relevant our debate is, and hopefully, the more that will attract people to participate in the IGF. Thank you.
So thank you, Matthew. Robert, now.
Dear Chairman, first of all, I want to congratulate you on your appointment to this post. Dear colleagues, now we have a very fruitful discussion, and I would like to join my opinion to the fact that the key issue of our examination is a result of the IGF. Bali was an excellent forum, and we thank the host country for its hospitality. Its forum was very informative and interesting, but what are the change in the world after it and now? The question is what value will have next IGF in Istanbul as part of the global discussions about internet governance? Who, when, and for what reasons will consider the opinions of the IGF participants? We need to talk about the future of the IGF and how to increase its value improvement. And the second point is a question of what should be the role of the governments in internet governance. For example, in the protection of human rights, privacy, and etc. I think that we have to discuss this topic. Thank you.
Thank you very much. And as you represent the parliament, I think that the participation of parliamentarians in the debate of internet governance is equally important than participation of governments in that, as well as other stakeholder groups. That is evident. So next is Anna Neves.
Thank you very much. And first of all, let me greet you and Marcus for your leadership in this very challenge process. Well, I think that we have to have a deep reflection on the workshops, on the format of workshops, and on workshop proposals. But I think that this discussion will take place later on. One of the main points that I would like to underline now is about the main sessions. I think that the main sessions didn't work in Bali, and I think that we should reflect on that, because they should not compete with the workshops. There should be no competition, but complementarity. Another point that I would to underline is. Is about the IGF village that we had last year. Unfortunately, it didn't work. only the governments were allowed to be at the main entrance. So all the others, stakeholders, the others that are really working on the field, so they were really far away, and I'm not sure whether you all that were in Bali, you know, where they were. So that is something that we have to work on, as these people, they paid for it there, they travel, so they paid for the materials, and so we have to have an eye on this. Finally, I'd like to talk about the need to increase the participation of governments and parliamentarians. This increase of the participation of governments, even if some stakeholders they don't understand, it will be extremely useful for all the stakeholders. So maybe the Brazil meeting that will take place in April, and that was so much discussed in Bali, might be helpful on this, as some governments are expected to be there. So it's like a plea for all that are organizing this meeting to have this on mind as well, because we need to call the governments in all the different settings and different fora. Thank you.
So thank you, Anna, for your reflections. Indeed, the placement of the sort of participants in exposition should be reflected, and we really need to think how to arrange it in Istanbul. So next to my list is Jim Pendergast.
Yes, thank you, Chairman. I'm offering these comments not as a member of the MAG, but as an individual who has participated in several IGFs, as well as working with organizations to propose panels. I don't envy the position that the MAG is in, having to review all these proposals, but I do want to give you some insights from somebody who sits on this side of the equation. I was excited to be in Paris last year for the consultation, where there was plenty of discussion about alternate formats for proposals and workshops, you know, highly interactive sessions versus the panel speaking to the audience. Having been a moderator for a highly interactive session in Baku, where we had about 75 people in the room, 31 of which took to the microphone, certainly one of the highs of my IGF experience over the years, which was quickly followed by one of my lows, which was going to a session with 8 talking heads and 5 minutes for questions and answers. So I would just ask that the MAG consider and take into account these alternate formats when reviewing proposal submissions. I certainly don't envy the job that the MAG has trying to review 175 proposals in a very short period of time. But when you look at something such as diversity, a panel that is supposed to be a workshop or a highly interactive discussion generally won't have 7 names from across the globe included in the panelists. So therefore it suffers immediately for not being diverse when trying to fit it squarely into a spreadsheet that assigns numbers to these different values. So I would ask that, you know, more time be given to the MAG to review the proposals, and that accommodations are made for these new and encouraged different formats that we want to try and encourage for valuable input and participation. On the input phase, you know, personally, I found the new system that we had last year a little more challenging than the previous process, both for inputting the proposals to the website for submission and review, but also when reviewing them. I know, you know, an output function I think the MAG may have gotten a PDF with all the documents outputted to them, but I think something like that would be good for the community as well, because to open up each proposal and review it, I think I had to click on 5 different tabs to get the information about the entire proposal. So if there's a way to look into maybe more user-friendly technology on that end, I'd certainly appreciate it. In Bali, I was involved with a flash session, which was a new format that we worked into the program. I thought it was a very creative way to accommodate more proposals when we didn't want to accommodate more proposals. The shortened time frame allowed for more people to have their sessions. I thought the formats were good. You know, 45 minutes may not be enough time for some topics of discussion, but what I found with our session with youth and digital citizenship is that the conversation very quickly spread out into the hallway and continued for an hour afterwards. So it kicked off in a formal atmosphere and finished in an informal atmosphere. And then finally, I'm not sure, you know, honestly, I don't know about this publication, but I found it very valuable, and I would encourage that the Secretariat highlight it even further, and that was something called IGF Today. I found that around the corner in the back at Bali, thought it was a very well done publication that probably deserves a little more of a highlight and a spotlight, maybe something closer to the entrance every morning that to ensure that every attendee does get a copy of it, because I thought it was a very well done publication and something that should be rewarded. Thank you.
So thank you, Jim. I have three further requests for the floor, and I wonder if there are further requests that we could, because it seems to me that we're gradually starting to repeat ourselves slowly drifting in the discussion about IGF 2014. So I have Anriet, I have Tovela, I have a United Nations Economic Commission for Africa, our friend Makan, and I have a request from delegation of Netherlands and delegation of United States. So may I then consider this list closed for this part of the debate. So there is another request. Okay, Anriet, please go.
Yanis, I think I'd rather have people who have not spoken yet speak before me, and if there is time, I'll make an input.
Okay, thank you. I call now on Tovela.
Thank you very much, Chair, and congratulations on your appointment. My name is Tovela, and I am from the NEPED agency, which is a technical agency of the African Union based in South Africa. I am a first-time MAG member, but I have been involved in several internet governance initiatives in the region. I want to echo very strongly the messaging about government participation, especially for our region. And I want to also make the case that I think it's very important to take into account that in our governments, there's a lot of the turnover is high. So one has to make sure that the messaging is going to the governments on a regular basis for them to stay informed and stay up to date on what is going on. But I think that there's also a need to make sure that the messaging to the governments includes aspects of the origins of the IGF. I think a lot of people are very familiar with the WISIS process, and when one mentions the IGF as an outcome of the WISIS process, they're able to relate to it much quicker than if we just talk about it outside of the context of WISIS. I think that there's also a need to stress the importance or the impact that the IGF has in language that policymakers can actually understand. When we talk of things like local content, when we talk about things like linguistic and cultural aspects, those are things that they can actually relate to and which they can then basically make a case for actually engaging with the IGF. I also think that it is important for the IGF, whether it's through the MAG or through the Secretariat, to strengthen the national and regional processes as a way of increasing participation, but also as a way of reaching out to our governments as well. And in this aspect, I would also want to stress the importance of including parliamentarians and our regional economic communities in the conversation. On the issue of online participation, I think that for our region, this is also very important, but I would also stress that it does need to be facilitated on both sides, because we still have significant issues in terms of access, and one therefore has to understand that even when we have online participation, it is mostly done through hubs, and those hubs need to be resourced and they need to be facilitated. Thank you, Chair.
So thank you very much for your observations. UN, United Nations Economic Commission for Africa. Okay.
Good afternoon. Thank you, Mr. Chair. We wish to provide our thanks to and appreciation to Marcus for having guided the IGF process successfully up to Bali. We welcome also the new chair and the host of the next IGF, Turkey. We support the analysis which were made by the Secretariat on the assessment of the Bali IGF. However, we would like to single out the following two main issues we had. The first one was the visa. Several potential participants from Africa could not take part because the letter of offer for visa were put on the website very late, hence preventing our stakeholders to take part. So most of them have to cancel. So I hope this year we will get visa facilities earlier. Also, the second one was a lack of interpretation facilities for the workshops. The booths which were provided for the workshops did not have interpretation facilities, hence forcing people to use one language. While in Baku we had a possibility of having interpretation paying from our own resources. I hope this year we'll have possibilities also to make interpretation at least in two languages. Thank you, Mr. Chair.
So thank you for these observations. Now I call on Netherlands.
Thank you, Chairman. I'm speaking here on behalf of the Dutch IGF and as an observer. Let me start by congratulating you with you on your new appointment and thank your predecessor, Marcus Kummer, for his excellent work, as well as the Indonesian government for hosting a very successful IGF. Now, on the lessons learned and the way forward, just a couple of points I would like to make. It has already been said by Mike Nelson, the open forum organized by the Netherlands. Yes, indeed, we have organized an open forum in Bali on cybersecurity, and we expected to have this item on the screen, but it was quite disappointing to see one-liner and saying an open forum organized by the government of the Netherlands. That's a very nice title, but lots of people ask us what's behind this, what's the content, real content, and we had to explain that it's about cybersecurity, a very important issue. So my request to the MAG is, please, if governments are going to organize or international organizations are going to organize an open forum, please make it explicitly that it concerns a certain topic, make it visible. On the workshops, the selection of workshops, I'm not going to repeat the excellent words by Marilyn Kate on how it went on last year. I was in the room, but I'm not going to say anything what really happened, but certainly one message to the MAG, please try to improve the selection process. Let's have transparency, let's have very clear criteria upon which those workshops will be selected. I know it's a tough job, 150 or so workshops to be reduced. But at least be very transparent and have very clear criteria. The amount of workshops should be decreased as well. We tried to do that, but I think the same amount of 150 workshops were during Bali present, but this should be lowered down for the next IGFs. New faces and new themes. New themes, we are going to work on it today and tomorrow. New faces, truly, very, very important to have new people in the room. But the main question is, how do we get those people in the room? If we're talking about developing countries, yes, indeed, we should get those countries on board. And we are working on it. We could imagine to have a pre-event before the IGF is starting, pre-event only dedicated to the developing countries. That could be a useful tool. Another tool could be to have workshops or training for the developing countries. The Netherlands has organized two workshops last year in the framework of ISOC, one in Kenya, one in Argentina, to explain more specific what spam is all about and how we can fight spam. So this could be a way out. Next thing I would like to touch upon is the how can we improve the outcomes of the IGF. In the Dutch IGF we have continuous discussions about this, and every time it's coming back the same message: well, it's very important to have these discussions, but what can we deliver? I mean, lots of people are gathering and discussing the same themes, but nothing is coming out of it. Industries are having a nice expression about this, and they are just saying, well, we are thinking that we are just bumping our heads against a glass ceiling and this has to be improved. So thoughts are on the table to perhaps come up with recommendations ending up discussions in the IGF, but certainly not binding decisions. Let me be very clear on this. Now, last item I would like to touch upon is the renewal of the mandate, or to have a new mandate. Several people in the room has already touched upon that, and we are very interested to know more about the whole process about such a new mandate, because we all know that in 2005 the IGF was a result of a political deal, but in 2015 we have to know what can we expect. I mean, if you ask me, certainly we would continue with this extremely useful platform in the near future, but we would like to know more about the details of the process. Thank you very much.
So thank you, Arnold. I think we will be talking about the process, and that will be most probably tomorrow, or in the context of the discussion this afternoon. So now I call on the delegation of the United States. Liesl.
Thank you, Chair. I was trying to respect your agenda setting and not making some brief comments about looking forward to 2014 earlier, so I'll just take a moment to do that now. I was also very remiss in not thanking the Secretariat and Changotai and his team for all of their hard work throughout the year and at the IGF itself, you know, with all of its challenges and opportunities of organizing such a big event. Having said that, I think that, you know, we feel that we still need to address the staffing issues, which you have somewhat addressed today, and we look forward to further developments in that regard, both for the special advisor position and for the secretariat team and staff, so that we can realize some of the great recommendations that certainly came out of the CSTD report, but also that many of MAG members and other stakeholders have in sessions like today. Speaking of the CSTD's report, we realize that many of the recommendations have a financial impact, presumably on the Secretariat and the very stretched trust fund that provides the resources. However, some of those recommendations can continue to be realized in the planning for the IGF and through the efforts of all of us here and more to make the IGF more inclusive and globally represented to capture the output or the value of the IGF. So, in that regard, we would endorse the idea of including discussions about that value and the IGF's impact at the IGF itself in some way that makes sense to do so. We would like to endorse the recommendations that have been made today for things like workshop proposal assistance, diverse formats, evolving themes to reflect the issues of the day, as difficult as they might be, and front-loading as much of the preparation and information dissemination to the community as much as possible. And this means that at this two-day meeting, we really need to determine the criteria for the workshop so that can be made available to the community as soon as possible, as others have said. And we'd also like to echo the comments about increasing even further and diversifying participation in the IGF. We know of organizations that have been able to help bring delegations of developing countries to the IGF meetings, for example, including the IGF Fellowship Program and even my own government, but certainly not only us. I continue to believe that we can do a better job of recognizing those that have sponsored such delegations, not as a laudatory mechanism, but rather to demonstrate that there are efforts from the community that provide an opportunity to those who might not be able to attend on their own. I'm probably now moving out of the agenda format that you laid out, Yanis, but since the future of the IGF and the mandate has come up, I'd like to just make a brief comment about that. The U.S. is a strong supporter of the IGF, and we continue to increase our level of engagement in the preparation for and proceedings of the IGF. In addition, we were able to make a contribution to the IGF's trust fund in 2013. So we thank those that we join as continuing contributors and new ones, and we encourage other countries and stakeholders to do so as well, so that it continue to serve as a vital organ for the internet governance discourse and the resource that it has become. So in fact, in the UNGA deliberations for the ICT for Development resolution in December, we did attempt to include a provision to extend the mandate for the IGF earlier than required, so that the IGF would have some of that predictability and sustainability for the future. Apparently, that was a bridge too far for last year, but we were pleased at least that the resolution included a recognition of the importance and success of previous IGFs, as well as an expression of gratitude to Turkey, Brazil, and Mexico for their offers to host the next three IGFs, which would extend it beyond the mandate. So I'll close there, but I just wanted to address that aspect at least of the process and our support. Thank you.
So thank you. Now I call on Son Jung.
Hello, my name is Sun Jung-byun from Korea Internet and Security Agency. I became a new MAC member for 2014, and I've never attended IGF meetings before. However, I just would like to have some comments on IGF based on what I felt as a beginner of IG area. I've attended various meetings related to the data protection, cybersecurity, and standardization, etc. And I've never seen a meeting like IGF that tries hard and put great value and effort to involve as many stakeholders as possible, such as government, industry, civil society, and developing countries as well. I think this value is something that IGF should continue to keep on the way forward. And also, I've never seen a meeting like IGF that covers this variety of issues at the same time regarding internet. And that's why it's really important to balance or organize or coordinate subjects and issues to draw more tangible output and outcomes that every participant can bring back to their own community to get more valuable results in their community. I think getting more participants involved greatly rely on how the results of this meeting affects or helpful to the participants. That's why the role of MAC would be very important for 2014. It's my honor to be a new MAC member of this year. I hope Korea or KISA as a member of MAC and as a participant of IGF can make meaningful contribution with our experiences in various internet areas regarding cybersecurity, data protection, and internet ethics, etc., to draw more tangible output. And cooperation with agencies like KISA would be welcomed. Thank you.
So thank you. Sun Jung, and I'm still most probably did not pronounce correctly your name. Apologies for that. We have done a sort of round on the lessons learned in 2013, and I think there were three main areas of questions which came out of this discussion. One is the logistics and early announcements were that everybody is aware and preparing for the meeting. Then the second bigger area is the preparation and work of the MAG on the selection of workshops, for instance. And this is where I did not hear really a lot about whether we're satisfied or not. A few referred to criterias, and do we need to set up a new round of discussion about criteria so we can just take those criterias which were identified in the preparation for 2013, and what would be maybe lessons from the selection process in 2013. So that would be something I would like to hear more from you. And finally, of course, then the a bigger substantive debate about the IGF and what issues should be addressed, and whether that would be carved in stone, taking into account historic perspective, or we need to be more flexible and react on maybe developments which we do not anticipate at the moment of preparations. So let me maybe ask you a bit more about your feelings about selection of the workshops. This is important. We need to launch that process at the end of this meeting, and we need maybe to have exchange on that. Anyet, if you would like to start.
Thank you, Yanis. And my comments actually would have included that. And also I'll start by remarking specifically on that. I think we can discuss new criteria, but I don't think that's the fundamental issue. I think the fundamental issue has really been more in the execution of our process. The problems have been in the execution rather than in the process itself. I think the criteria themselves are actually, I think, pretty solid, and you know, we can revisit them. It always is good, but some specific problems. I think Jim Pendergrass's points, I endorse those. We need more transparency. There were excellent workshop proposals last year focusing on intellectual property issues on the internet that somehow were not selected. And, you know, rather than make assumptions about strategic voting amongst MAG members, I think we should just have MAG members make their votes transparent and visible to the internet community. So that's one improvement. And then I think, again, it's an execution issue. We already have a criteria that workshop formats should not be talking heads, as Jim was saying, but we're not applying that effectively. So we still end up really encouraging proposers to have participation and not a panel of 8 or 10 people. But when you get to the IGF, you have those massive panels and you don't have participation. I think there the solution would be not so much in criteria, but following up on Marilyn's proposal, mentoring after the selection process. So I think selection should really be on the substance of the topic, of the proposal, the relevance of the topic, and regional diversity, and I think bringing in new voices, but rather than on a number of panelists. And then once a workshop has been accepted, I think then a more active mentoring process with the workshop proposer, making sure that the format, the facilitation methodology ensures that there is interaction, that there are not too many panelists. And maybe we can then work on a process of MAG members being assigned to do that. We can share the workload amongst ourselves, maybe in regional groupings, with workshop proposers. So I think more hands-on mentoring, as Marilyn was proposing. I also think we should make the flash session modality formal and announce that. Although some might argue it's good to have it as a fallback option, as we did last year. But I'd rather see it as a modality for shorter sessions and make that available to the IGF community. Because what happened last year was that we weren't able to say no to certain workshops, and then we can't say no, so then we look at an alternative way of accommodating rejected proposals, so we came up with flash sessions. And I think it just again is a manifestation of our inability to be firm and apply our own criteria rigorously. So I mean, in summary, I think that's, you know, it's not so much the criteria, I'm not opposed to changing them, but I think the execution of the process needs to be firmed up. And then the support. And then I just wanted to quickly remark on the participation issue, because I think it's linked to this. I think on government participation, you know, I hear two different responses in the room. Some people say the ministerial is good, they like that, that's enough. Others are saying we need something more. I think the issue of ensuring effective government participation needs more discussion, and maybe that can be a MAG working group. On bringing in new faces, I think we can play that role in our workshop selection and in the design and planning of main sessions. But until we have some financial fund that we can use to bring new people to the IGF, it will always be a hit and miss affair, because ultimately, we are limited to select speakers from among those that are there, or that have patrons or donors or that are local. So I think to be systematic in deepening participation, which I think should be based on substance, not just on newness, having a participation fund, this proposal has been made before, I think, that the MAG can use for main sessions, and possibly that workshop organizers can propose or apply to, would help diversify participation. And I just quickly want to make just two general points. I think we should keep in mind that the IGF is about public policy and about internet governance. It's not a showcase for best practice and using the internet for development. It's not an ICT4D forum. It's different from WSIS and the WSIS forum. It's really about policy and governance. So I think if we're having best practice forums, if we're showcasing successes as has been proposed, let's keep in mind that we want to showcase issues related to governance and policy. And just quickly, I think the renewal is a fantastic, I'm glad it's come up again. And I wonder if we can't propose that the renewal is done for 10 years rather than 5 years, to give us and the whole internet community and the UN system more time to do this properly.
So thank you. We have about 5 minutes to conclude this this morning's session. Maybe we can go some minutes beyond, and I will call first and foremost to those who haven't spoken yet, and Suzanne is the first one.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. My name is Susan Chalmers. I'm a MAG member. On the workshop selection criteria, I think that there are two components. First is the criteria that the workshop submitters must meet, or that should be reflected within their proposals. Second, I think that there needs to be a selection process that is sensible for the MAG to use and that is also transparent. For those new MAG members who are here, a workshop streamlining working group was established last year. A proposal was made by that workshop group. And there was subsequent discussion on the proposal on the MAG list. For the MAG members, I have just circulated a digested version of that discussion, including some PDFs of the threads, so that would be good for reference for a discussion tomorrow. I also just one final point on the MAG selection of workshops, the process. You'll see in the email that I sent out, there were two basic approaches. One was kind of a numerical-based approach, where you could have a binary system, you vote up or down. On criteria, it's very, very numbers-based. The second one is a more is less so. It's a more qualitative, less number-based proposal, and I think that these are two different poles. Two different approaches that the MAG could consider in developing and eventually arriving at an agreed upon approach for workshop selection process, which I sincerely hope that we'll be able to do by the end of tomorrow. Thank you.
Thank you. There is a question or comment from remote participant.
Thank you. I have a comment from Andrew Maurer, a new MAG member. He says, a thought on format and content. I remember being a part of a session on spam policy in Athens when an African gentleman in audience put up his hand and asked how to set up a blacklist at the ISP he'd set up. It was at that point that everyone in the room started talking with each other, exchanging business cards and drawing diagrams on the back of them, rather than the rather titled panel session we'd had up until then. It was fantastic. So one thought is whether we can move away from panel sessions to a more free-form methodology. The other thought is whether we can put a premium on subject matter that people can take away and build on or use at home. It doesn't need to be highly technical, though I like the Isaac thought on IXPs, etc. Maybe a session on what works in terms of stimulating new and active multi-stakeholder participation at a national level and then at an international level. Thank you.
So thank you for those proposals and thoughts. Fiona?
Thank you. I just wanted to echo the comments that Susan made and maybe suggest a way forward. I think there's not a shared baseline understanding of the process that was used last time, nor the discussion that's happened on the MAG list in the intervening period about criteria. I think everyone agrees there needs to be criteria, it needs to be clear, it needs to be transparent. And beyond that, I'm not sure that there's any further, you know, agreement on how to do it and not wedded to any one model. But I think this could take a substantial amount of time for us to talk through. So I don't know with the current agenda how we could do that with just one session tomorrow morning. So perhaps if there's a way to sort of put all the material that's currently out there in one spot. I know Susan tried with her email, and then people can take a look at it and start a conversation today with the goal of finishing tomorrow. I just think it's at the flag. I think this could take a certain more amount of time of work than people are thinking it will take.
So thank you. Carolina?
Yes, thank you. I would like to second Henriette's proposal. I mean, in terms of being firm and structured in our agenda, in our calendar, in our criteria, I think that Susan's work and Fiona's comment just raised is essential. We need to move forward. There's work being done in the past 8 months about this, so we need to move forward and we need to take advantage of the possibility that we're here tomorrow. I think that we really, from a developing region's viewpoint, if we want more faces, if we want new people, if we want new proposals, we really need this new fund for new participants. It is actually impossible to do it with the current situation and with the current funding structures that we have in our regions. And if we cannot be firm on our criteria and on our calendar, I wouldn't like to repeat the sensation I have every year that during July and August we're just revising workshops and submissions that are coming in through the window and not through the main door and the main entrance, as we should be working and we should be aiming at having really institutionalized procedures and structures so that people really know the rules of the game and we all play by the rules of the game. Thank you.
So thank you. And last in this part of the session, I will call on Subi. And others who have requested for the floor will get it at the beginning of the next session. Subi, please.
And as I realize I'm between lunch, I'll keep my comments brief. This is an important topic, and which is why I feel compelled to make an intervention. The workings improvement and ratings process, as a new MAG member, we looked at about 200 proposals in a week's time. It was completely voluntary. The secretariat told us that new MAG members do not need to undertake this exercise. I'm just glad I did it. With Teresa Swinehart, who's no longer on the MAG, we led a breakout group that looked at deepening multi-stakeholderism and enhanced cooperation. I strongly urge that we revisit the criteria for workshop evaluation and proposal rating systems. When we ask questions in the forms and we do not link those responses to how they're going to be treated or evaluated, there is a gap. we can create funds for people, but we will not be able to facilitate their participation if we have a system that keeps people out. If we have questions or rating-based points on diversity, a developing country proposal cannot have five speakers from across the world because they might not have the necessary linkages with people from different expertise. Geographical diversity, again, a similar point. When we are rating people at a proposal submission stage, even on a virtual call, we had proposed that we should first look at initial proposals based on topics, whether they're from a new member or whether they're from a country which is underrepresented, especially an LDC, we should give them priority. On the question of whether IGF can be a platform for best practices, I think it is important. In India, we're struggling because all the sparrows have disappeared from the capital. It is important to have governance and internet governance that develops the internet. We need to look at connecting the next billion online, and proliferation of the internet is equally important than just merely looking at processes as to how we can best govern it. So in the new criteria, we've all been working together with Fiona and Susan on setting a new criteria. It is important that either we filter it as a two-stage process or we have criteria that privileges access and quality, not just numbers of people who do exceptional proposals, but new voices that can be actively facilitated by MAG members. I think that is our primary responsibility as the MAG. We also need to revisit these proposals and workshops when they take place or unfold at the IGF. Just having a broad-based criteria that 17 panelists is not a good idea. For a session that is a round table with young people, multi-stakeholder participants, which is not a panel, they might propose 17 names. So we have to look at these proposals with agility and use our discretion when we evaluate these proposals. And we should be able to have free and fair conversations as to how we can include diversity, privilege, access, which is a very real question for both India and China. Thank you, Yanis.
So thank you, Subi, for those proposals. What I would like to encourage, since you have an opportunity to look through...
Mr. Chairman, so the interpreters are now leaving.
...which is originated during the debate, and I cannot. So please do that and respond or engage on the proposals or sum up that Susan has sent out on this very important topic. Indeed, we have... our task is to agree how we will do the workshop selection, and we need to get to that conclusion by end of tomorrow. So a lot of things to discuss and then think through. Therefore, this online debate among members of the MAG would be very important. So that brings to the end of this session. I would like to thank interpreters for letting us work slightly longer. And what I would like to encourage, please come back at 3 o'clock sharp, and we will start at 3 o'clock sharp. I'm coming from the country where the punctuality is a culture, as in this country where we are. So though we are on UN grounds where punctuality maybe is not so sort of observed. So we will start at 3 o'clock sharp, and thank you very much. Bon appétit.